theme of American involvement in worldly affairs was, is, and will be the most prevalent theme in American history. The amount of people that are aided by American involvement around the world is more significant than any other country in the history of civilization. America has stood to protect the morals of free enterprise and free people of the world since the founding of the nation. The American Revolution was a war that took place from April of 1775 to September of 1783. In the span of 8 years, over 50,000 people lost their lives to fight for America's freedom. This is America's first encounter with the world, yet it is not the last. Due to the number of important events that happened in this era, like the signing of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, it is the most important era in American history, and sets the early foundations of America in the world. The Founding Fathers, like Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, and many more, all wrote in documents supporting the freedom of America.
The Founding Fathers did not, sadly, see minorities or women as people, but they created the most generous and helping nation in the world. Though the most common aid that the United States provides for the world is disaster relief, the United States military has always defended the nation's ideals. This beautiful nation was founded out of rebellion to the crown, and was spurred on by average citizens. The country was shaped out of war. In both descriptions of the very first war, and in our founding documents, the knowledge that America would impact the world as a unified nation is evident. In the Declaration of Independence, the founders of our nation cite that one of the driving forces for separating is for cutting off our trade with all parts of the world. The king had separated the colonies from the world, and America could not survive. This is why, in the United States Constitution, there are two specific mentionings of international trade. The United States had to become involved in world politics because of economical and other strains, and the Founding Fathers anticipated and planned for this. The early revolting United States only came to be due to foreign aid, mainly from France. Over 12,000 Frenchmen came to America to fight the British, more than 12% of all that fought for America. The French had no place in a war in the New World, but they aided America almost purely out of hatred for the English. This is not relevant, but it is the first of many military alliances in American history. The French were inspired by the American Revolution to revolt against their own tyrants. Within the first 50 years of America's existence, it had already changed the global landscape forever. War is not positive, but the results yielded by the United States after almost every war benefit many more than are harmed. Charles Lindbergh argued against the United States getting involved in World War II, and he makes several valid points that enforce the idea that America must be a strong presence. He says, "If a nation is to survive in a hostile world, its ideals must be backed by hard logic of military practicability. If the outcome of the war depended upon ideals alone, this would be a different world than it is today." Hello, what is your name?
My name's Dave Drescher. I have been a big history fan since I was probably 7 or 8. When I went to visit my grandfather, and they didn't have TV up there, there was a big book on the Civil War. And I read that thing basically from cover to cover. And since then, I have just taken it as a hobby to learn about American and world history, and with a little bit of a attention towards military conflict.
What was the most important factor in America's victory in the Revolutionary War?
So, it's actually a combination of the colonists' resiliency and the fact that Great Britain at the time was fighting other countries and didn't early on view the war or the revolution as much of a big deal. Those two factors combined allowed a lengthy engagement to go to the colonists' advantage.
Okay. In the early years of the United States, what began to shape it into the superpower it is today?
So there wasn't one factor, but there might have been a couple of very important factors. One was their expansion into other territories of the United States. The resources and the wealth that came from that really helped them along. The second aspect was the creation of their Navy. And as a matter of fact, their Navy and that expansion was part of what helped them defend themselves in the War of 1812.
Do you believe the use of force by the United States has benefited the world, and how?
Yes. World War I and World War II are the greatest examples of that. The world had fallen into severe conflict, could have gone on for much longer than it did in both cases. But the United States' involvement there pulled them out of those terrible, terrible conflicts.
Dungaree doll, dungaree doll, paint your initials on my jeans so everyone in town will know we go around.
Together, together, together.
Dungaree doll, paste my picture on your sleeve so everyone can see that you belong to me forever.
America and the world is the most important theme of American history, with the involvement of worldly affairs during the Cold War era. The Cold War spanned from 1947 to 1991 was a long and nerve-wracking time period. America's involvement during the Cold War has changed the fate of many countries across the world. The Cold War was a war of ideologies. It was in America's best interest to fight communism abroad. The Yalta Conference was a meeting between Churchill, Roosevelt, and Stalin to decide what would happen at the end of World War II. The topics discussed include partitioning of Germany, the fate of Poland, United Nations German reparations. The Americans wanted to help Germany and the surrounding countries because Europe's economy suffered greatly during World War II. Not only this, but these Eastern European nations were weakened. They were vulnerable to communism. America believed if Germany strived economically and industrially, the rest of Europe would follow. Russia, exhausted after World War II, did not want Germany to succeed because they saw him as a threat. They were a threat because they had been conflicts in the past with them, and Germany had already rebuilt from one war. In the 20th century, they could do it again. Due to that, East Germany suffered under communism because of Russian control of that area of Germany. The Western capitalistic parts of Germany succeeded due to their connections to the United States.
Born through a party in the county jail.
Another way that Americans involved themselves in worldly affairs was during the Cuban Missile Crisis. On the date of October 16, 1962, the Cuban Missile Crisis happened. Russia controlled Cuba, so they supplied Cuba with weapons of mass destruction. With the help of spies, America quickly figures out that Cuba is being used for a nuclear launch pad. For a week, American citizens feared for their lives, thinking that they were on the brink of a nuclear holocaust. With their failed attempt of removing the weapons with Operation of the Bay of Pigs, Americans confronted Russia about their nuclear missile placement. After the conference with Russia, they agreed to remove their nuclear bases from Cuba if Americans removed their nuclear bases from Turkey. With America's involvement in the Cuban Missile Crisis showed that nuclear war can be rebunted with compromise.
Cuban Missile Crisis, your parents are around that, and
yeah.
You were a little born before that, but you were still a child, but do you have any memory of your parents going through the Cuban Missile Crisis?
I do, and in fact, I can remember when I was in first grade, which was 1964, 65, that back in those days, we still had drills, bomb drills, in the case of nuclear war, where you would hide under your desk and pretend that that would save you, right, from a nuclear thermonuclear blast. It was a pretty scary time. So You know, America's role in world affairs, you need, the world needs a strong America, you know, who values that freedom. Otherwise, you've got other regimes that don't value that freedom, like Russia.
America's involvement and its status in the world has given it a unique situation in its foreign affairs throughout American history. Since the end of the Second World War, America has always seemed to play the policeman or superhero of the world, aiding oppressed or disadvantaged people and fighting against oppressive ideologies. One of America's most imperative but often forgotten battles against oppression was its involvement in the Korean War. In the 1950s, the Communist Soviet Union was seeking to expand its influence into Asia and consequently ended up in Korea. In response to the Soviets, the United States launched its own campaign in Korea, encouraging and fostering democracy and capitalism while also stopping the spread of communist ideas. Consequently, the clash of the two fundamentally opposite ideas and the world's two most powerful countries divided the country into North and South Korea and erupted into war. The fighting was in many cases particularly brutal. The United States' early involvement and support of the South Koreans is why the United Nations forces were able to capture nearly all of the Korean Peninsula in only 4 months. However, when the Chinese intervened on behalf of the North Koreans, the United Nations forces began losing ground quickly. They lost the North's capital city, Pyongyang, on December 5, 1950, after capturing the city only 2 months earlier, on October 19th. After pushing the Allies back to a small corner by the country's southeast coast, the fighting continued for 3 years, eventually ending in an arms assist that has continued into the 21st century. Americans' involvement in the world has created situations that still strongly influence political and economic agendas to this day. Today, I will be interviewing my father, William Mitchell, on his opinions of the Korean War, and on his father, John Mitchell, a veteran of the Korean War. Do you believe the Korean War was a justified use of force?
Yes, I do. I very much believe so. They just didn't use enough force initially. And MacArthur got himself into trouble by disobeying orders as to how much force and how to apply it. Personally, I think they should have gone all the way to the Chinese border and more if they had to.
Do you think that the Korean War helped or exacerbated the Cold War?
Well, of course I would say both. But to put the detail on it, I think it gave the communist bloc, which I will simply define for now as China and the Soviet Union, it gave them some pause as to what they could do, when they could do it, and how they could do it. They realized the West would fight. And I think that saved Western Europe from being rolled over.
What kind of things did your father do as a soldier in Korea?
He was a U.S. Naval Seabee, part of a construction battalion. So those construction battalions had been pared down quite a bit after World War II, and they needed to ramp them up very, very quickly. So when he got out of high school in 1950, he was summoned very, very quickly to the U.S. Navy as a Seabee. And in the case of Korea, they built airfields, bridges, roads, docking facilities to help with invasion logistics, lines of supply, and things like that.
Did he ever share any stories with you of his time in Korea? And if he did, can you share one?
Not too much. Of course, when you're a kid, you have a lot of questions. And the only ones I really remember was he was a CB and he was not frontline combat on the ground or in the air. But in working on an airfield somewhere, he did tell me there was a particularly bad period where the North Korean artillery could reach them, and they tried to reach them often. And a couple of guys around him were killed and badly wounded. And he said that was pretty scary, because there wasn't anything you could do. You're not prepared for that.
Do you think America's foreign affairs have had the biggest impact on American history?
Sure. There's a lot of ways to answer that question, but I believe our involvement in World War II and the resultant victory, which gave the world the U.S. reserve currency being the dollar, that put us in a position to rebuild the world and to resist communism.
Is there anything we didn't cover that you wish to share?
Yeah, I think there sure is. Back in the USS Pueblo incident in 1968, most people won't remember that, but that's when the North Koreans seized the U.S. intelligence ship off the high seas. It was big news for a long time. And I remember him saying directly at home, he said that this problem should have been solved a long time ago. A lot of people got killed over this, and he doesn't want to see any more people get killed over this.
Who did?
My father said that. And if he were alive today, based on things he said in the past, and that particular North Korean problem, he would like Donald Trump a lot.
The Vietnam War is connected to the theme America in the World because the U.S. went into Vietnam with the idea of stopping communism spreading throughout the world. The Vietnam War was a conflict between the communist North Vietnam against South Vietnam and its ally, the U.S. In 1961, John F. Kennedy sent a team of U.S. soldiers to report the conditions in South Vietnam, how much aid they needed, and to evaluate the ferocious Viet Cong. After a thorough evaluation of the situation, the theory they came up with was if Southeast Asia fell to communism, then many other countries would follow, which simply could not happen, according to the U.S. So for the sake of the world's freedoms, we officially entered Vietnam on March 8, 1965 to stop the lunatics known as communists. The corruptivity, controversies, and scandals revolving around the Vietnam War are still unmatched by any other war to this day. The Vietnam War will lasted from November 1st, 1955 to April 30th, 1975 and was the cause of over 3 million people, including 58,000 Americans' deaths. Although many perished, they did not die in vain, as the evil known as communism was stopped in its tracks and Vietnam was finally liberated. There was a lot of controversy surrounding the Vietnam War, as many people in America believed we should not have gone in the first place. It also was the cause of many youth dying for unnecessary purposes, so the people at home believed. The result of many people's outrage and anger was the cause of many riots all over the country, especially in Washington, D.C., and outside of the Pentagon. The Kent State shooting and the My Lai massacre helped add to the growing war protests as well. The war divided people bitterly, as for some, the war symbolized a form of unchecked authority, while others believed that opposing the government was unpatriotic and treasonous. Although there was many controversies, corruptivity, and protests surrounding the Vietnam War, it was the right thing to do to stop the spread of the growing communist ways. Although America did not succeed in this war, it shows the integrity and the desire by the U.S. to make a change in the world. Without the intervention of America in Vietnam, the communism within North Vietnam would have spread to surrounding countries, and eventually the values of our enemy, Russia, would be everywhere. The war helped to stop the spread of communism within and out of Vietnam, eventually leading it to be a free nation, benefiting the people living there, America's interests, and helping to secure the world's freedoms to this very day.
For being interviewed, what is your name?
Ronald Fiorella.
What is your relationship to the interviewer?
I'm the grandfather.
War. How old were you when you went into the Air Force?
I was 19 and a half years old. Well, my first base was Dow Air Force Base in Maine. I was there 18 months. And then from there, I got orders to go to Puerto Rico for 2 years at Ramey Air Force Base in Puerto Rico.
Like during and after the Vietnam War?
Well, during the Vietnam War, I was in stationed in Dow when it first started, and it sounded kind of new to us. We didn't know what to make of it all, and when I was in Puerto Rico, I didn't I read too much news or see the news because I was away in another country. And but after I got out of the Air Force in 1967, the country was a
choice to go into Vietnam. And do you think the domino theory was an accurate assumption?
At the time, I thought it was a good idea to go into Vietnam and win, and to stop the domino theory of the communist spreading and into the Philippines, and which I believe they did.
It did not win the Vietnam War. Do you think it stopped communism from spreading throughout Asia?
Yes, I think it had a real big impact. It stopped it. There's always going to be communism. But they don't want to wake up the big bear, the sleeping bear, I guess they call us.
How does communism relate to the Vietnam War?
The North was communist, and they were spreading their communism, trying to spread it to the South. And that gave us a good excuse to go to Vietnam and try to stop it and get involved in a war.
Vietnamization, and what is your opinion on it?
My opinion on it was that the Viet Cong just did not have the will to win that war. We tried to. That's the reason why we got out. They just didn't have the will. The North was very determined, and the South just didn't have it. That's all.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. I had fun. Thank you.
As a result of the September 11th attacks against the U.S. in 2001, in which the terrorist organization Al-Qaeda claimed responsibility for, the U.S. retaliated against terrorist organizations with strong military force. On October 11th, 2001, American and British forces began an invasion and bombing of Afghanistan. By December, the Islamist Taliban government in place had crumbled. Even after the fierce Allied strikes, bin Laden was yet to be found. Throughout the 2000s, there were hunts throughout Afghanistan for the men responsible for the killing of thousands of American citizens. Many soldiers endured the grueling hunt for Al-Qaeda personnel in the constant sweep of remote hideouts filled with potential dangers. Many soldiers reported finding leftover clues of the 9/11 attacks throughout these hideouts.
Several sources now that the President of the United States will announce in just moments that the United States has the body of Osama bin Laden, that Osama bin Laden has been killed.
In May of 2011, the mastermind of the 9/11 attacks, Osama bin Laden, was killed during a Navy SEAL raid. Bin Laden's death brought justice to those killed almost 10 years before. Through the 10 years it took to find bin Laden, the United States developed new security measures at home and abroad. TSA security at U.S. airports implemented new measures and restrictions to prevent weaponry from reaching the cabins of planes. The U.S. also had to find new ways of fighting the enemy. Terrorist fighters typically took refuge in towns where there were many innocent civilians. U.S. troops had to be trained to make difficult decisions and know when to attack and when not to. An American infantryman has decided to share his experience in Afghanistan.
My name is Eric Morrison. I was 7 years old on September 11, 2001. Don't remember much, just that school got dismissed early and the attacks were all over the news. I I enlisted in the Army Infantry when I was 19. Went to basic training in Fort Benning, Georgia, and it was 16 weeks long. It was hard, but at the same time, it was pretty fun. You ended up getting to know a bunch of dudes, and I don't know, it wasn't too bad. The focus of the Allies while I was in Afghanistan was to train and advise the Afghan forces, so eventually the U.S. forces could like push out and let them fight their own stuff. A lot of things we were doing was guys would go and like burn all the like drug fields and stuff down so the Taliban couldn't profit money and cut their resources off like that. The assignment in Afghanistan was very different from the Texas one for sure, because Texas is garrison, so it's back home. You do all training events and stuff like that. I went to South Korea right out of basic, and I mean that was interesting. It wasn't like, I didn't really think like it was bad, because everyone was kind of not on high alert or anything over there. And Afghanistan is a whole different story because stuff's going on around all the time, and it's a different ball game over there. It was a little more civilized than I expected it to be. There wasn't so much activity in Saddle Base, but I was attached to a SOAG, they call it, Special Operations Advisory Group. So they were like the head of all like the operations, and we had Navy, Army, Air Force, and all, everyone staying together. So it was pretty cool to see. I got to do some cool things. Inside the base, security was, always maintained 24/7. We never had an interior attack or anything like that happen while I was there. There was a couple other bases around me. Camp Gibson was one of them, and they were more segregated from the rest of us, but, safety is probably this equivalent on this, all bases.
The fight against the Taliban in Afghanistan continues. But now the U.S. fights the world's new enemy, ISIS, or the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, in Afghanistan and the rest of the Middle East. The combat is as grueling as ever, with heavy casualties due to the barbaric ways of ISIS. Security in the U.S. and abroad continues to become tighter as the conflicts in the Middle East continue.
It's getting lonely down here. Things I've been up to lately have kept me from saying clear. Why do you keep on running? This love is fading.